So, good morning, everyone. Let us do the usual check of audio and video. We will start shortly, just a moment. Okay, so I think we can start. And as we agreed yesterday, we will split this lecture in two parts. In the first part, I will continue describing the system engineering problems faced in the BepiColombo mission. And in the second part, we will review, I will answer your questions and doubts about topics of the course. And we will move on Zoom. So I will provide you with a Zoom link and we can continue on Zoom. So yesterday, I think we stopped the lecture with the various configurations that the BepiColombo project considered for different launches. And let me see if okay. The final orbit that was decided, and we'll talk about the spacecraft, but anyway, I want to show you the final orbit, which is certainly very different from a Neumann transfer orbit, because you see how complicated it is. The launch was further delayed from April 2011 to October 2011, but essentially the arrival date, the arrival time, was essentially the same. So we had a 6.7 year cruise, two Venus flyby, four Mercury gravity assist, and so on. And capture will be in late 2024. It does not differ much. So the mission was designed to have a 1 year nominal mission, plus the possibility to extend it by another year. So essentially 2 years at Mercury. There is a number of trajectory constraints which the mission designer had to take into account. So let us review some of them at least. The launch window, it was not a problem because there is a 30 days launch window, which are quite frequent, every 9 to 15 months, more than allowed by chemical propulsion. Then, however, critical operations had to be avoided in periods of solar conjunctions. So when the sun the Earth and the planet are aligned, so suppose that we are in a situation like this. This is the spacecraft. Okay, so the radio beam passes through the solar corona. Well, operations are impaired, radio tracking is complicated, orbit determination is heavily degraded, and critical operations cannot be carried out during conjunctions. Also, gravity assists must not occur during eclipses. Eclipses also. Yes, eclipses, let us say, period of orbit of solar conjunctions. There were limits to the sun aspect angle of 10 degrees, plus minus 10 degrees for thermal and power reasons. And here we have reported some information about the thrust, the solar electric propulsion system. The thrust could be modulated from 75 mN to 290 mN. The specific impulse was fairly large, more than 4,000 seconds. And the total impulse is more than 11 meganewton per second with the ion engine. The total thrust duration and the SEP was qualified for 2.8 years of continuous thrust. De facto, the thrust was modulated. Bepicolombo was not thrusting continuously, but was thrusting when it was favorable, when it was more favorable to thrust. So there was an optimization procedure to separate, to identify the arcs of the trajectory where thrust could be particularly effective. And you see here the approach to Mercury. Mercury, remember, is has an orbital eccentricity of 0.21, so fairly large. And we start from one astronomical unit here, and we slowly we have the two Venus flybys, which will bring us close to Mercury. You see, in this type of orbits, the red arcs, you see, the red arcs are the arcs where the SEP solar electric propulsion was active. The other are called coast arcs because the spacecraft is moving only under the influence of gravity. And we have the Mercury flybys, the four Mercury flybys here, and the final one when we have capture. So a lengthy approach. The capture in the weak stability boundary of Bepicolombo by Mercury, I won't comment on it. I just say that there were ample margin for capture, and because the relative velocity in the end was very small, the differential velocity. So we think that the capture would be quite easy. And at Mercury, essentially four events have to take place. First of all, let me see if, yes, let us look at here. First of all, we have to get rid of the Mercury transfer module, the solar electric propulsion module that, if you remember, was laying underneath Bepi Colombo. It has to be jettisoned. Then the second step is to release first the MMO, the Mercury magnetospheric orbiter. And then you have to get rid of the shield, the thermal shield for the MMO, and reach the final configuration, which is this one. So this is done by jettisoning and detaching in steps all these elements. There are limitations in all this, and remember that you have to acquire also the final orbits for the MMO and the MPO. So the first thing is the separation event from the solar electric propulsion module, which is not listed here. We have the separation first of the MMO, then we have the separation of the thermal shield, and we have a number of delta Vs here. You see? One, two, three, and four events. This delta V put the MMO, MPO thermal shield, which are still attached to each other, into the final orbit of the MMO, which is a highly eccentric orbit. And remember that due to thermal reasons, critical operations cannot be done in this arc because this would imply an attitude of the spacecraft for the release that is incompatible with the limitations, with the flight rules that require a certain attitude to protect the spacecraft. You cannot do anything during solar conjunctions, as we have said here. Again, another set of thermal limitation here. So you are forced to do these events, separations and delta V in sequence. So there is a number of delta V, additional delta V events for the MMO and the MPO. Okay, all these events. And how are these delta Vs obtained? These delta Vs are obtained by using an enhanced attitude control system based on thrusters. Bepi Colombo uses obviously reaction wheels, but for wheel desaturation, we know that thrusters are needed. But the thrusters used for the desaturation maneuvers are also providing the delta V for these maneuvers, so they can be used for orbital maneuvers. This led to a big simplification because initially the project we thought to have a separate chemical module to do all these maneuvers, but this would have increased the mass further. And as you know, the mass was one of the main problems that the mission, the project faced. So all this takes place in approximately 2 months. And look, the delta V, the total delta V required for Mercury orbit insertion, is absolutely not negligible. It's almost 1 kilometer per second. And to have the thrusters designed for attitude control to deliver this delta V, I mean, it means that the thrusters must be quite good. One of the things that helped a lot in the later phases of the project, not the initial phases, was that MESSENGER measured the gravity field, and especially J2 and J3, because these orbital elements cause an important precession of the orbit. Okay? And let us go directly to the orbit, how it is. The orbit, and actually, in my view, there is a mistake here, because it should be the perihelm is about 15 degrees north here, and the apohelm is down here. So it should be reversed. We start from 180 kilometers at 15 north, and then precess, but that is less important. And let us see how the orbital elements evolve due to the gravity field. What you have here, I still myself difficulty in reading. This is the perihelm altitude. So we start from 480, let us say 500 kilometers, and at the end of the mission we end up to 250 kilometers. So the eccentricity of the orbit increases, and this is a consequence of J3. J3 changes the eccentricity of the orbit. The apoherm altitude goes from 1500 km to 1700 km. So the orbit becomes more eccentric. And you may wonder whether this poses a thermal problem. And initially, when we got the first measurement of J3 from MESSENGER, we were a bit scared, because the spacecraft was designed to survive at 400 km perihelm. Remember the infrared radiation emitted from the planet is a significant fraction of the total thermal input into the spacecraft. So the question is, can we survive at 250 kilometers? Well, if the spacecraft is at the equator, certainly not. But luckily, we have a drift also of the argument of perihelm in degrees, which is here. So we start from 15 degrees north, and luckily the perihelm drifts at lower latitudes in the southern hemisphere. So at the end we are at about 50 degrees. So at 50 degrees, the surface of the planet is definitely cooler. And therefore, this mitigates entirely the increase that one would get from the decrease in the perihelm altitude. So the two effect cancels each other, and we are in a quite favorable situation. In a quite favorable situation, even better in a sense, because this precession of the periherma allows baby Colombo to observe the planet from a closer distance and also map better the southern hemisphere. So the initial scare went away, and we realized that thanks to this favorable J3, we could have in the end a better mission. Okay? We were a bit lucky, let me say. But another important point is shown in this chart. You can see that the orbit of the MPO of Mercury is eccentric. Eccentricity E is equal to 0.21. So at perihelion, sorry, not perihelion, perihelion, Mercury is at 0.3 astronomical units. At aphelion, it's almost at 0.47 astronomical units. So if you compute the thermal input from the Sun at perihelion is about 2.5 times larger than at aphelion. So there is a large variation. Effect of 2.5 is large. When Mercury is in quadrature, as here, we have an intermediate thermal input at a distance of 0.37 astronomical units. So the power flux, the solar flux, varies significantly from aphelion and perihelion. And so does the maximum temperature of the planet. At aphelion is about 140 degrees lower than at perihelion. So the perihelion obviously is the most complex situation. So the obvious solution to cope with this varying solar input, solar power input, and infrared thermal power input was to put the line of nodes and the line of apses, sorry, the line of apses of the orbit. Remember, the orbit is polar, in such a way that the spacecraft is farther from the planet at perihelion and closer to the planet at aphelion. So essentially trading and balancing the lower thermal input from the Sun at aphelion with a larger thermal input from the infrared radiation at aphelion, and vice versa at perihelion. So this orbital configuration, which was adopted in the end, mitigates the thermal problems and mitigates a lot the complexity, and complexity means also mass, of the thermal control system of the spacecraft. So you see, you have to take into account the thermal environment and planes and design an orbit profile which mitigates the complexity of the thermal control system. So also this is an important point, design point. So these are the orbits, and let us look at a bit on the design challenges and the system engineering challenges. So, what are the design drivers? Two spacecraft and Mercury. Launch capability is restricted, but not too much, not as with the chemical propulsion system. The configuration is certainly complex. Scientific experiments with a lot of different requirements, a lot of different requirements. The mass constraints had to be always met, and that was the major problem. And remember that for 1 kilogram in orbit, this means on the launch pad 2.1 kilograms. For the MPO, you need 3.4 kilogram. Why? Because you are getting in an orbit which lays deeper into the gravity field of Mercury. Then electric propulsion with all the problems that it entails. A thermal environment which is very, very harsh. Another thing that has to be taken into account in the design is that due to the proximity with the sun and the high intensity of the UV radiation, temperature and contamination, the thermo-optical properties of the surface and the solar cells themselves, the performance of the solar cells, changed with time and decreased with time. And then, of course, one needs to design a system which is as much as possible fault tolerant and single point failures are not tolerable. It was a requirement of the mission. No single point failures. And even in the solar electric propulsion system that we will describe briefly, we will see that even if one engine fails, we have the possibility to reach Mercury using two engines instead of four. Then there are requirements which are also mission drivers. We need a global and high resolution coverage of Mercury. This means stay low with the spacecraft nadir pointing for almost all of the time. And of course, the low altitude has implication in terms of thermal insulation, heat pipes, radiators, etc. Another important requirement, mission requirement, was that the mission should have been able to deliver 1,550 gigabit of data in 1 year. In 1 year of nominal mission. And this implies sizing the antenne, sizing the transmitters, looking at the ground antenna, and so on and so forth, as we have seen during our course. Then, especially important given the harsh thermal environment, the survival mode, the design of the survival modes, the spacecraft must have survival modes in case of failure, which allow to withstand a harsh environment during the various phases of the mission. And this implies software complexity and a number of other consequences. In terms of autonomy, spacecraft autonomy, for how long can a spacecraft survive without contact to ground? This is another important design parameter. The spacecraft was designed to withstand an outage of up to 4 weeks. So, if communication is lost, there is a fault on board, the spacecraft orients itself in a survival mode first and can stay there autonomously for up to 4 weeks. Other important drivers of the mission are the new technologies. Remember, and I will show you later a slide perhaps, only 18% of the components of the mission were off-the-shelf components. Most or a large fraction of the elements have to be designed from scratch or modifying heavily previous elements. Why? Essentially because the thermal environment. No other spacecraft had survived under those conditions. Even Messenger was in a much more favorable orbit from the thermal point of view. It was a very high eccentric orbit. And then we have all the tasks of the and requirements of the MMO, a much simpler spacecraft, but that was under Japanese responsibility and we will not talk about it. Cost, of course, cost was a big issue because the spacecraft, the mission faced the risk of cancellation once when it was obvious that there was a significant cost overrun. And luckily we survived. It's interesting to see, and this is the project manager point of view, because this slide has been written by Jan van Kasteren. And let us see some implications. So first of all, we always said the requirements are developed in a top-down approach through a hierarchical structure. So we start for a science mission from the science requirement, and this led to the production of the mission requirement document, which is updated iteratively. But it's something that once it's cast in concrete, engineers have to fulfill. This drives system specifications. And after that, there are interface control documents between all the subsystems, and then lower level specifications. So this is the, broadly speaking, the requirement flow. But the requirements, the development of the requirement is an iterative process. We start by being, for example, quite conservative, by wanting a lot. Scientists want a lot. And it becomes clear that at some stage that those requirements cannot be met. So what do we do? At least cannot be met with the mass and cost limitation. So they have to be revisited, and in the revisitation, one has to understand what is the science loss in not meeting those requirements. So this led to a design evolution, continuous, in which between engineers and engineers and scientists. And there are interesting examples. For example, the need to do planetary and magnetospheric investigation at the same times implies two spacecraft. And this has implication on the mass, the total mass of the system, has implication on the trajectory, and ultimately led to the adoption of solar electric propulsion as a system. Okay? The need for high resolution and global coverage implies a low polar orbit, so with continuous nadir pointing. And this implies surviving in harsh thermal conditions, a large radiator to get rid of the heat flux in the spacecraft and from the heat internally generated by the spacecraft electronics. And this led to flip-over maneuver, we will talk a bit, multi-layer insulation, a lot of heat pipes, and also limiting the downlink capability of limiting and defining the downlink capability and the need for an articulated high-gain antenna. The cost limit implied a single launch and the cancellation of the lander. And these are suggestions from Jan van Kasteren. Beware of two challenging requirements created by wishful thinking. In every project, we are in the Christmas tree phase, in which we think that we can get a lot of presents under the Christmas tree, but the reality is different, and scientists and customers in general have to mitigate their requirements. On the contrary, and in the same line actually, one must beware of over-specification. One must never over-specify the system, because over-specification led to a more complex system, and of course, in the end, forces a revisitation of those specifications. What I show here is an interesting diagram where you can see the documentation tree. We said that the documentation is very expensive, very costly. And you see here, starting from the requirements, these are documents, all these are documents that are produced when the project starts, the statement of work, science requirement document, environment requirement, space to ground interface document, launch interface control document, assembly, integration and verification requirements, product assurance requirement, management requirements. This is the same for the MMO interface requirement, the comprehensive mission analysis document, and I don't even know what is this ESCOS 2000. Sorry for that. But the documentation, we have about 600, 700 documents which are continuously updated. And in a complex system, this is unavoidable. And I told you already what kind of mistakes can be made if the documentation is not under proper configuration control. So, again, some philosophical guidelines. Requirements may be too stringent as a concept of conservatism. But conservatism, being conservative, originates from lack of knowledge. This is also extremely important. So we tend to over-specify because we want to take margin and we are afraid to fail. And we are afraid to fail probably because we don't know too much. We feel insecure. And this insecurity is essentially driven by the lack of knowledge. A good engineer, a knowledgeable engineer, knows very well how to assess problems and finds the solution which is the reasonable compromise between risk, complexity, and costs. So, over-specification generally derives from lack of knowledge. And I can tell you that in my IC, I participated in more than 10 space projects, and I have seen engineers of different level of knowledge. And this is very easy to recognize those who stick to over-specification because they don't feel secure in what they are safe, and they want to take additional margin. So this is something that, however, only experience and a good scientific background can provide. Okay? The requirements tend to be conservatives, of course, in the initial phases of the project, when we don't know too much. But then they tend to be relaxed when the design becomes more mature. There is a set of rules called ECSS. ECSS is an acronym which stands for European Cooperation on Space Standardizations, are books and books, documents and documents of prescriptions. And they are extremely useful when they go into the detail on how to do a soldering, how to carry out verification of the mass properties of a spacecraft, etc. But when they try to specify at system level what has to be done, the rules may not be applicable to specific case. So it's the ultimate responsibility of the system engineering team to design the system, sometimes going against the ECSS rules. And the lesson learned from Jan van Kasteren at the end of the project, because now the spacecraft has been launched, are the following. Keep questioning continuously the requirements. Are they reasonable? Aren't we over-specifying? Can things be done better? What does the mission really require? And how much margin does the project really need? It's easy to take margin, okay? But it's extremely complex to design a system with margins which have been over-specified. And ECSS, if you will become a system engineer, but even in general in space, you will hear a lot of ECSS rules. ECSS, take that with a grain of salt. They are not the ultimate truth. And much more important, maintain common sense engineering, be reasonable. So I didn't write these sentences. These are the sentences of a person who was leading probably the most complex planetary mission that ESA has ever undertook. So this is the final system that came up at the end. And I don't want to go into big details. Let us go a little bit. Let me show you what is the spacecraft, how the spacecraft looks like in the end of we are close really to the end of this hour. I need another 5 minutes, and then we will do the question and answer. You see the MMO in the clean room, the MPO in the ESTEC clean room, 6 meter tall. You see the MOSIF, the thermal shield. You have the MPO here, and you have the Mercury transfer module here integrated. One important thing is that when you separate all these elements at the arrival of Mercury, you are left with gaps, with holes, because there are flanges that were used to attach one element to the other. These holes are huge heat sinks for the spacecraft, and they needed to be closed. Otherwise, too much heat would enter the spacecraft. So there were deployable protections that closed the holes at the separation point between the various elements of the system. And for the MMO and MPO, there were in total six of them. Let me go ahead. Rather than giving the characteristics, I would like to stress only two things. The thermal issue. As you can imagine, the solar electric propulsion generates in itself a lot of power, 2000 watts. The Mercury transfer module, where the solar electric propulsion is hosted, does not have a thermal dissipation system. It was decided to use the thermal dissipation system of the MPO radiator. Okay? And this is the MPO radiator with all the heat pipes. All these are heat pipes. You see? Some are below, some, all these are heat pipes carrying the heat from the hot side to the cold side. So imagine that this radiator stays, never looks at the sun and never looks at the planet. It's not easy, and I will show you what was the solution that was devised. So there is fluid that evaporates in the hot side, is carried at the radiator where it cools down, it condenses, and therefore transfers heat from one side to the other. There is the latent heat of condensation, which is radiated away by the radiator. And this is the largest surface of the spacecraft. It's more than 2.5 meters in length. And here, this is the surface of the radiator, you see. But the surface of the radiator is interrupted by what? Here, since this points to deep space, these are the flanges for the star trackers. Three star trackers oriented at 45 degrees angle from each other that look to deep space for spacecraft attitude determination. This is a scientific instrument, and there is also a low gain antenna here in this plate. We have the attitude thrusters here and also here. You see, in this position. But generally, this side is used for heat dissipation. On the other side, we have instruments, the camera, and the laser altimeter. This is the laser altimeter flanges. And we have the camera. I cannot even see it better. We will see it better in another slide. Plus additional thrusters. 22 Newton, so fairly large thrusters. Here we have the high gain antenna, steerable. You can see the steering mechanism. This is the azimuth axis, and this other is the elevation axis. Unfortunately, the elevation axis motor, stepper motor, has to stay outside with a big problem because it has to undergo more 500 degrees Celsius temperature difference. So it was a really complex design problem having a elevation axis outside. You have the antenna here. Multi-layer insulation in the side exposed to the sun. This is the MMO. This is another view of how the instruments are accommodated inside. There is a platform where the inertial, the gyros, the IMU, inertial measurement units, and the star trackers are located on the same bench, which is called also the optical bench, because also the camera is mounted on the star tracker plate for obvious reasons. You do want to know where the camera is pointing as much as possible. If there are thermal deformation, internal thermal deformation, and the star tracker are located elsewhere, you would end up with an angular error in the pointing of the camera. And here you see the camera, the optical bench with the four elements of the camera. There is a wide angle camera, a narrow angle, this is the wide angle camera, a narrow angle camera, and other elements of the camera. The laser altimeter, aperture, the receiver, and the transmitter are located here. Then other instruments placed on board, but I want to skip. I would like to just to show you two things. The history of the mass margin. So it's a complicated, let me skip this. We already told that margin that we have been able to meet the 20% mass margin. The mass margin ranged from 7% to 2%. So we were really close to big, big problems. And I don't want to go, I said this already, but let me go down. Also the power budget would be interesting. But let me say two things. We said that the radiator has to face deep space. The radiator is placed with its normal into the Mercury orbital plane. Okay, so we have the spacecraft here with the solar panel. You can see the solar panel in blue. The radiator has to point away from the sun. So in this part of the orbit, for example here, the radiator points always away from the sun. But when we pass the line of apsis of Mercury, the radiator, if we keep the same situation, so with the radiator here and the solar panel here, the radiator would face the sun. And one has therefore to do at perihelion et aphelion a maneuver, a rotation of the spacecraft along this axis, which reverses the orientation of the radiator, so that in this half of the orbit, the radiator still points to deep space. It's the so-called flip-over maneuver. Flip-over maneuver. And finally, let me show you, well, these are the thrusters. I want to find one, to show you one thing. All this is interesting, but we don't have time to tackle it. Also, the telecommunication part would be interesting. I don't see the slide that I wanted to show. All this would be interesting. Okay, here we are. You see here an example of the multi-layer insulation, the MLI, which are part of the heat shield. Look how complicated it is. This is the blanket with the MLI. This is the face which Nadir pointed, so points to Mercury, with the laser altimeter transmitter here and the receiver here. They are telescopes. And the camera assembly. And here the thrusters. You can see the thrusters. This is another science instrument for particles. Now, this is the last slide that I want to show you. You may wonder, but are we sure that the radiator, we are in polar orbit, so the MMO orbit is this one, that the radiator doesn't receive heat from Mercury? Of course, if it's oriented, if the radiator is oriented in this way, there will be some heat reaching the radiator from Mercury itself. And this is a big problem. So the solution was to protect the radiation from the infrared radiation from Mercury with fins. These fins, the minimum angle that is needed is 59 degrees, which is determined by the altitude of the MPO over at perigee over the surface of Mercury. So we don't want thermal radiation from Mercury, infrared radiation from Mercury, to enter the radiator. And this, you see, this is the radiator. All this, which is covered by tiny fins, like the one of a Venetians. Okay? And these fins make sure that no infrared radiation from Mercury reaches the radiator. So, I would stop here this part. There would be a lot of many interesting things to say. Unfortunately, we don't have time, but I wanted to give you an example of how complicated is to devise a system like this. A system which has to survive a harsh environment. And this is only a partial justification to the delay, 5 years delay in launch, which is something that led to cost increase and also a lot of frustration. So I will quit here and we will spend the final hour with question and answer. This time we will not make the break. The break will be done when I set up the Zoom session to which, and I will give you the link to Zoom, only just a moment. So I start my personal meeting on Zoom and I write here the meeting invitation. So you have can you see the meeting invitation? You can do a cut and paste of the Zoom meeting, which is this one. So let me know if you are able to join Zoom using the password is not necessary. And I stop the streaming. Actually, I will stop streaming only when you make sure I got from you confirmation that you are able to join Zoom. So you don't see the link? It's on the chat. I wrote it on the chat. Is HTTP Zoom blah blah blah. The meeting ID. If you want, I can send the invitation on. This is very strange. Let me try to redo it. Yes, the link is in the comments, but I'm not able to. So I will do the following. I will send the link to the class through Google Classroom. Okay? Because It's stuck. I cannot. Let me do it again and see if. Okay, this goes. Let me see if this goes. Okay, here is the link. I don't know whether it's complete or not. Can you try? Try to connect with that link. All right, it works. Let us wait to reach. I have to admit a few people. I don't know why. I thought it was automatic with the link. Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, can you hear me? We have 38 people. And a nice echo. So probably yes, it's better if you close your mic unless you want to talk. A nice echo. So probably yes, it's better if you close your mic unless you want to talk. Okay, I think we can start. So I hope that you prepared, but why there is this echo that I cannot, there is somebody. Wait a moment. So let me first, oh, now I think I understand.